Welcome back to The World Over. My next guest, syndicated radio program, reaches over 5 million listeners coast to coast. He's here to talk about his latest book, now in paperback, The American Miracle, Divine Providence in the Rise of the Republic. We'll also talk about the culture, the dismal summer movie season, and a couple of new movies. Welcome back to the program, best-selling author Michael Medved. He joins us via satellite from Seattle. Michael, thanks for being here.
Oh, what an honor, Raymond. Great to speak with you.
Oh, it's always a pleasure being with you. I want to start with the book. In the book, you start by explaining how even our most secular founding fathers really had this belief, this conviction, that the hand of providence was somehow involved in America's rise. You quote Lincoln from his first inaugural, and it says this, intelligence, patriotism, Christianity, and a firm reliance on him who has never yet forsaken this favored land are still competent to adjust in the best way our present difficulty. Could this be a key to carry us through our current woes, do you think?
Well, it has to be, because one of the great difficulties that we have in this country is how do you explain how America came to be? The most popular explanation today, at least in the universities, is that, oh, America was rapacious and evil and exploitative and slavery and genocide against Native Americans and exploiting the environment and destroying this and sexism and racism. And okay, the problem is that every other country in the world, particularly Spain and France and Portugal and other colonial powers, were much worse than the United States, but without the same result of power and prosperity. So that explanation doesn't work. And then you get to this other common explanation. We've had a lot of happy accidents in America. Yeah. Except, as you know and I know, Raymond, a pattern of happy accidents is still a pattern. Yeah. And it's evidence of design, not of random evolution.
Why did you decide to highlight these particular moments in American history? And you really go back from the revolutionary period, down through history, through Lincoln. And I mean, it really is a sweep where you see divine providence at play in this American experiment.
Well, what I focus on is a series of 12 stories that were seen by contemporaries as evidence of God's hand and God's intervention. Beginning with the pilgrims, who were blown 250 miles off course to almost precisely the right place, one of the very few places in North America where they had any hope of survival. And they were very, very aware of all of these signal indications of divine favor, because there had been previous attempts to start British colonies, as in Roanoke in 1585, that had failed miserably.
Yeah.
And you go through the Revolution. President Washington, in his first inaugural address, said we have to acknowledge the invisible hand. And he didn't mean the invisible hand the way Adam Smith did. Mm-hmm. He meant the invisible hand of God that had allowed America to emerge. And you see, one of the things that people acknowledged is we often look back and we think, look at these founders we had. We had Madison and Jefferson and Adams and Washington and Franklin and these remarkable people. And that's why America did so well. Except all of those people, including those who were unconventional religious believers, saw themselves as the instruments of design and not its authors. Yeah, I think that's important to remember and to recapture.
Yeah, and many of these men were not men of faith. I mean, you couldn't, you know, they were deists. In some cases, you know, they were agnostics. But they all had this sense that there was a divine hand in the work they were about and in what was happening around them. Tell me for a moment a story very near and dear to my heart as a New Orleanian. You mentioned here the Battle of New Orleans, Andrew Jackson, and the interaction with a particular order of nuns, the Ursulines.
Yeah, the entire story is incredible. And one of the things that's amazing is, do you know that January 8th used to be a national holiday to celebrate the amazing American miraculous victory in New Orleans?
Yeah.
And part of what happened is Jackson came down with militia facing what at the time was the largest overseas army that Britain had ever sent anywhere. and facing the a brother-in-law of the Duke of Wellington, who was commanding these vaunted British veterans who were known as Wellington's heroes, against these American frontiersmen and some freed slaves and who had come there from Santo Domingo. The entire story is so astonishing. And one of the parts of the story that I hadn't known before I started writing The American Miracle, is there was the oldest convent in North America. It was the Ursuline Convent in New Orleans, which is still there.
Yeah.
And the nuns began praying and fasting the night before the battle. And they prayed to God through a statue of the Holy Mother.
Yeah, Our Lady of
Our
Prompt
Lady
Succor.
Our Lady of Perpetual Succor.
Right.
Of Prompt Succor,
prompt
thank
succor.
You.
Prompt Succor, but we wanted fast in New
what's
Orleans.
What's amazing, you bet, and on that Sunday, because it was a Sunday, as they were just celebrating Mass, the battle was over in 18 minutes, and the results of the battle were astonishing. There were about 3,000 British casualties and 7 American casualties, and everyone hailed it as evidence of a miracle. And someone ran in while they were celebrating Mass and said, miraculous deliverance. The city is not going to be burned, and the women are not going to be attacked and raped, as, by the way, the British had very much threatened to do.
Right.
What's amazing is that Jackson himself, he was a Presbyterian, came and visited the convent and thanked the Ursulines for having prayed and helped him win his victory, which is pretty remarkable considering some of the anti-Catholic prejudice that was so rife in the country at the time.
Right, right. It's a fascinating book, and when you look at when you stack these stories up side by side, they really do give you a sense that this was in some ways a God-made nation, and you know that we have an obligation to continue that sense that there is a divine hand here, and at least acknowledge it in our history as well.
Well, that's entirely right. And Raymond, part of the reason I wrote American Miracle is because a great deal of our national future and the health of our culture depends upon inculcating gratitude rather than guilt. And given the fact that we do live in a favored land, we're so fortunate to be here. We live lives that are so privileged compared to what our parents and grandparents and great-grandparents lived. If we don't feel gratitude, then of course you end up feeling guilt. And guilt is paralyzing and inappropriate for the United States, which continues to play such a remarkable and positive and called upon by God role. And what's fascinating to me here is also the idea of grace. Because one of our great national hymns, which I cite in the book, America the Beautiful, it says, America, America, God shed his grace on thee. And grace is a gift from God. It is what God chooses to use us for his own purposes. In other words, I think too many people sort of view the blessings that this nation has received as a return on investment, as we're good, therefore we will be blessed. And what our founders believed, and what certainly Abraham Lincoln believed, and the last three chapters of the book are about him.
Right.
Is that it wasn't so much a reward as it was God using the country as his instrument and his instrument for the uplift and redemption of mankind. And toward the end of the book, I quote Pope Pius XII, who right after World War II actually said that America has been called by God to serve the world with great and noble deeds. And that was a quote that I found because President Reagan frequently used it.
Invoked it, yeah. I want to shift to something less noble, and that would be Hollywood and some of the films we've seen tumble from it over the last few
Considerably
months.
Considerably not less noble, I
yeah,
think.
Yeah, I'll say. These box office numbers are pretty dismal for the summer. To what do you attribute that? Is it tech? Is it just bad movies or endless sequels and remakes that we've seen this season?
It's all of the above, but I think it actually shows something deeper that is not an encouraging sign in our culture. We don't have dating anymore. Part of what has sort of preserved the movie business is that it was a place where young people who were seeing each other could go out. Mm-hmm. And it wouldn't be as expensive as going out to a dinner, and certainly not as expensive as going out to a concert or to a play. You go to the movies. Well, first of all, movies have gotten more expensive.
Right.
And secondly, with our standards today, kids don't see each other. The equivalent of a date is talking through Skype.
Right.
Or going on to social media. Or checking out somebody with Facebook. Mm. And also, the whole idea, people hook up and they hang out.
Yeah.
And the notion that you're going to go together and escort a young lady, if you're a young man looking for a young lady, mm-hmm. to a movie is sort of quaint. And when you put on top of that the fact that movies are so expensive today, I mean,
right.
In many places it's $12, $15 mm. per ticket. And you put on top of that the fact that the movies have been so lame. I mean, so many truly terrible movies. One of the exceptions from the summer, Dunkirk,
oh, yeah.
was
great
suitably
film.
Rewarded. But so many of them have been... They did a movie called King Arthur that featured Jude Law and Charlie Hunnam, and it's... It's just unbelievably horrible.
No, I saw.
I mean,
how
can you louse up the story of King Arthur?
Even
well,
the trailer looked bad for that one. I want to talk about one of the big breakout hits of the summer, or the post-summer. It, based on the Stephen King novel about a homicidal clown. This is breaking all kinds of records. You did not like it. Why not?
No, because first of all, it's a low-budget film, and the Stephen King novel that it's based on is 1,000 pages long. And the film is 2.5 hours, and it feels like it's 1,000 pages long because it is unvaried, grotesque demonology. In other words, part of the problem with the Stephen King worldview is it contrasts with what I believe to be the most effective horror movie ever made. The most effective horror movie ever made, in my opinion, is the old original version of 1973 of William Peter Blatty's The Exorcist.
Yeah, friend Peter
and
Blatty.
And it's effective because it's good versus evil. The Exorcist is, in fact, heroic and makes sacrifices to defeat evil. Mm. Here, the evil is uncontested, virtually.
Yeah.
There are 7 13-year-olds who are supposed to be standing up against this killer clown who emerges from the sewers, and in the first 3 minutes of the film, rips off the arm of a 4-year-old as he bleeds to death. The movie is
charming.
Rated R, and one of the things that's shameful to me is they're selling it to 13-year-olds
right.
who technically should not be allowed to see this at all. Unless accompanied by a parent, and any parent who would take their child to see this is committing child abuse.
Good for you. No, I in the advertisements, they have been marketing this as like E.T. You know, it's kind of an adventure, and the kids get together, and they get on their bikes, and they chase down the killer clown. We don't hear that he drowns them, mutilates them, does all manner of things to them, so I'm glad you're enlightening the audience. Tell us very quickly about
Mother.
Oh, and
they're zombies. And by the way, in the original novel,
right.
In the original novel, and this is not on screen, but there's only one girl. There's one girl and 6 boys. They're all supposed to be 13.
Right.
She ends up having sex with all of them at once, and which is, you know, I'm sorry. this is not fun for the whole family, unless
I'll
it's the
say.
Manson family.
Yeah, no, I never, that's a Stephen King book I missed somehow, and I'm kind of glad I did. Tell us about this movie, Mother, which is getting some praise, a Darren Aronofsky film. What is this about? Big stars, Jennifer Lawrence and major Hollywood figures. What's the story about?
And Michelle Pfeiffer
right.
and Javier Bardem, Oscar winner Javier Bardem, and Ed Harris is in it. This is one of the most disturbing and altogether worst movies I've ever seen.
Oh.
It's appallingly bad. Everyone listening to us should be warned. The movie features infanticide, cannibalism, torture, mutilation, destruction, being burned alive. There
oh,
is
gosh.
A grotesque parody of the Sacred Heart at the end of the film, where one of the characters, while still alive, has a chest opened up and the heart removed.
Oy.
And the entire film is deeply disturbing and disturbed and with no point at all. And so unrelievedly dark and brutal and ugly. I think it's one of those things that every one of the talented people involved with it should feel embarrassed and regretful of this result. This makes it feel like Rebecca of Sunnybrook Farm by comparison.
Well, you know, all
you sort of long for the killer clown.
This is very revealing about the heart of our culture and what is being at least elevated in the minds of some and promoted, this dark, unrelenting sort of progressive evil. While your book, and I want to end with this, talks about something very different, which is this American miracle and the notion that God is guiding and a guiding hand in the Republic. Have you felt divine providence in your own life? At the end of the book, you talk about how you feel divine providence has touched
your
own.
I do. I felt divine providence. We recently were blessed, Raymond, with our first grandchild.
Oh, congratulations.
Our granddaughter, Julia Rose Medved, is now 9 months old. Oh. And when I met my wife, Dr. Diane Medved, author of the new book, Don't Divorce, and it's wonderful to be married to somebody who writes a book called Don't Divorce.
After all those years, you bet.
Diane and I met, on the most bizarre circumstances and with the most bizarre series of coincidences. And we felt from the time we got serious about one another, which was almost instantaneous, what I think a lot of couples feel, which is this is no accident. There's actually a beautiful section from the Talmud where Rabbi Yossi bar Halafta is asked by a Roman matron who is challenging his belief in God because she's Roman and she believes in the multiple gods.
Right.
And she says, your God, what has he been doing since creation? What has he been doing since he rescued the Jews from slavery in Egypt? And has he gone asleep? And Rabbi Yossi says, no, during that time, he has been making matches between husband and wife, and that's more difficult than splitting the Red Sea. In other words, it is harder to join together meaningfully than to split apart. And I do think that that sense of the miraculous, I met my wife, and again, I've written about it, so I'll admit it.
Yeah.
We met on the beach. We were swimming in the water, and this is the Pacific Ocean in Santa Monica. And I've often thought, if I hadn't gone to the beach, if I'd gone to the beach an hour later that day, or an hour earlier, and I would not have met Diane, and these three children and our now grandchild wouldn't exist, and my life would be immeasurably poorer and less blessed. And yes, I do think there is such a thing as providence and as destiny, and all Americans benefit from it every day that we live in this favored land.
Well, thank you for the book, Michael Medved. Mazel tov on your new granddaughter and for staying together with your wife all these years and having
thank
a beautiful
you.
Family. The American Miracle, Divine Providence in the Rise of the Republic by Michael Medved is now available in paperback. It's at bookstores and online everywhere. Michael, thanks for being here.
Thank you, Raymond, and thank you for reading the book so carefully and sympathetically, and God bless you.
Always a joy. Thank you. God bless you. Well, that is all the time we have until next week. The show continues on Facebook and Twitter. Like me on Facebook. Follow me on Twitter. Sounds so desperate. The links are at RaymondArroyo.com. Be sure to join us next week. Author and theologian George Weigel is here. He'll talk about his new personal memoir, Lessons in Hope, My Unexpected Life with St. John Paul II. Until then, we'll be scouting the world over for all that is seen and unseen. On behalf of the staff and crew of EWTN News, thank you for watching. I'm Raymond Arroyo from Washington, D.C. Bye now. We'll be right back.